Hello, readers and rascallions. My name is TB's Guy, and good lord, Riot have been dropping a lot of lore and a lot of lore updates on us over the past month and a half. I am a little bit behind on catching up on them, so for this particular video, we're going to be taking a look at six pieces of lore that were very recently added to the League of Legends Universe page, and that'll hopefully give us a little breathing room so we can catch up on the Soraka update, the Sylas update, the next issue of Ash War Mother, which is going to be out in like a couple of weeks, and good lord, who knows what else they have planned for us. Riot have done us a bit of a favor, and they have accompanied these lore updates with a patch notes, a patch 9.3 notes lore edition, detailing exactly what they were putting out and giving a little bit of context, especially on the updated bios, and we'll touch on that as we get there. But we're going to start with the three short stories that have been put out, because they fit pretty well together under you know, a single piece of analysis. They have very many of the same characteristics. They seem to be functioning very much in the same way as it relates to dealing with the characters at hand. And what I mean by that is that all three of them essentially take the form of small disconnected vignettes. These are little moments from the characters' lives that are sort of, we don't really know where they're placed in time, when they happened, or what they happened in connection to, because they didn't really happen in connection to anything. This is something, a little moment that happened in this champion's life at some point, which does a little bit to inform their character and lets us know a little bit about what their daily life looks like and what kinds of things they get up to, but they don't, you know, on their own advance the story of the character. They don't really bring them forward, they don't really push them towards any conclusions or towards any sort of substantial change. It's just a little bit of an insight into who are they right now, what's going on with them right now. This is what I like to call maintenance. And the derogatory way of talking about maintenance work is to call it filler. That is to say, it's something that's there, that has the characters doing what the characters do, but it doesn't really see them change in any meaningful way, it doesn't really see them upend any part of the status quo, and at worst, yeah, that can be meaningless fluff, that can be meaningless filler that doesn't really do anything, but when it's well written and it doesn't introduce a whole bunch of unnecessary subplots or interfere with any other parts of the storytelling, it serves as just a way to spend some time with the characters, it serves as a way to develop them a little bit, or at least to become more comfortable with how you want to perceive them. And it also, by the way, if just from a business perspective, it serves as a way to gather a little bit of feedback about this version of the character, how do we feel about that, both in terms and from the audience. So let's give those a little bit of feedback right now, starting with the Annie story trouble. Again, like I said, this is just a little vignette. It's a little thing that kind of elucidates on how Annie gets by in the world. How does she manage to find food when she's a tiny little girl who has no parents but does have a giant fiery hellbear by her side? And as it turns out, the way she gets money and food is by murdering people. The plot unfolds fairly simply. Annie turns up at a bar, a rough and tumble bar full of bounty hunters and unsavory characters. She goes up to the counter, she asks for a tankard of milk, and the barman, who seems to be kind of a kindly soul, just, I'll give you a tankard of milk and you can pay me with whatever you have in your pockets, I don't really care. And then she pulls out a giant purse of coins, and the bounty hunter who's sitting next to her is like, where did you get that giant purse of coins, little girl? And then we learn that someone annoyed Annie in the road, and then Tibbers ate him. The bounty hunter understandably does not take this seriously. He tries to take Tibbers away from Annie, which, as we learned in her little short animated feature, is not a great idea. So Annie summons Tibbers the Hellbear, burns the entire place to the ground, tries to spare the barman, although it's kind of ambiguous whether he survives, and then she walks off into the night having drunk her milk, sort of just giggling and happy, apparently entirely oblivious to all the people she just murdered. Now, we already knew from her bio that essentially the way Annie survives is by trading on the generosity and kindness of others. That is to say, she's a tiny, lost girl alone in the woods. Occasionally, she'll get herself picked up by a sympathetic family who'll take her in, give her some food, give her some new clothes that the old ones have gotten torn, and then when she's tired of dealing with them, she'll either kill them or just kind of disappear back into the woods. This here, then, is a direct demonstration of how she goes about doing those things, and the way she goes about doing it is by enacting the perfect, albeit rather trope-loyal version of the creepy, scary, very powerful, dangerous, psychotic little girl trope. So she talks very cutesy, she giggles a lot, she makes oblique references to murdering people that other people around her don't quite get, because she looks so small and cute, she couldn't possibly have murdered anyone, and this toy bear is just a toy bear that's definitely not gonna turn into a giant fiery hell bear and destroy me. Except the moment you annoy her, she switches on her Carrie impression and starts murdering everybody around her with fiery magic and death and destruction. So my only criticism of this particular short story is that it feels a little bit to me like Riot don't quite know what they want to do with any... They don't seem to quite know how they want to play her character. Because the character that we see in the Annie Origin short is a relatively ordinary little girl who has that, you know, low-grade sociopathy that all children at some level have because they haven't quite learned empathy yet, who witnesses first the death of her sister, is then blamed for the death of her sister despite not causing it, then her distress over the death of her adopted sister, admittedly, starts to flare up and cause her powers to set the entire house on fire, which causes her father to die in the attempt to save her, for which her stepmother, pushed somewhat beyond the brink by the death of both her child and her husband, starts blaming Annie loudly, which, you know, is kind of a reaction that maybe you can understand, but of course Annie doesn't react well to that, so she ends up murdering her stepmother as well. Like, it's this series of just horrifying, scarring, awful traumas that eventually creates the character who we know today as Annie. The trouble for me is that in this short story, I don't really see that character. I don't see that, you know, victim of just tragedy and trauma and loss upon trauma upon tragedy. I see a gender-flipped version of Damien from The Omen. That is to say, something which is evil and horrifying and terrifying, walking around just convincingly enough in adorable human skin that you underestimate it until it's too late and it turns into a monster and tears you limb from limb. And the thing is, I don't think it follows from she experiences repeated traumas and she's endowed with great pyrokinetic powers that she then becomes someone who kind of takes gleeful joy in destroying other human beings by unleashing her power whenever she gets angry. Like, she's afflicted with guilt for killing her father and, you know, not preventing the death of her sister. Like, that's one of the primary characteristics that's set up in Annie Origins, is that she is haunted, just terrified by guilt over her powers, which is part of what then transforms into these massive temper tantrums and outbursts when she just can't control all the turmoil inside her anymore. But the Annie we get in Trouble isn't the sort of traumatized, shut down, kind of terrified, guilty little child. The Annie we get in Trouble is someone who's at least putting on the appearance of being entirely unconcerned with everything that's happening around them and who's capable of turning on their powers at will when something annoys them, rather than having that power forcibly unleash itself when she becomes unable to contain her anger. It's the difference between causing a death accidentally and feeling bad about it, and causing a death on purpose because someone or something was annoying you and it was the most convenient way to get rid of that annoyance, and it's the second version of that that we're seeing in Trouble. Now, you can get from one to the other, like, you can take that traumatized, broken child and eventually transform them into something of a sociopathic killer, but we haven't really gone through that process with Annie yet. Like, since Annie Origins, we haven't really had any lore updates for her, so how exactly she went from one to the other isn't clear, and that's why the characterization of Annie right now feels rather confused to me. We need a kind of a link between those two states of the character in order to explain how she gets from unprocessed trauma that is shutting her down as a person and preventing her from forming meaningful relationships to, I will summon my hellbear to destroy you if you annoy me in a bar. Anyway, moving on, the next story is Katarina, Message on a Blade's Edge. Now, this one is even simpler than Annie Origins. The only real character development we get for Katarina here is a little bit of an insight into her current relationship with her father. The story itself takes the form of just an account of an assassination she commits on an enemy of Noxus, someone who's in open rebellion against the triumvirate of powers that are running Noxus right now, specifically in open rebellion against Grand General Swain, who Katarina serves. The main thrust of the action is first-person action storytelling. Essentially, Katarina is narrating what she's doing as she's vaulting over guards, destroying soldiers, getting closer to her target, and kind of showing off for the cameras, as it were. If this was a sequence in an action movie, it would be shot like a John Wick movie. Now, action writing can be really hard to do without getting incredibly tedious, and can be really hard to do while still keeping a clear sense of, like, what's the progression of events, what's going on, where are they, how is the fight staged, and who are the actors that are involved, and what are the stakes. This story does a pretty good job of just the technical aspects of that. Like, I never felt myself getting confused or annoyed by the action writing as I was reading it, which is something that happens to me quite often when I read action writing, because a lot of authors get kind of self-enamored with the action movie that they're directing inside of their own heads, and they go overboard describing how cool everything looks rather than just describing what happens. And this story does a really good job of just describing what happens and then letting it look cool in our heads. For those who don't remember, Katarina is born Katarina du Courteau, who is the daughter of General Ducoteau was a major general in Noxus, and he's the one who, alongside probably all the tutors, taught her to be an assassin. And the framing device of the story is that while Katarina is going through the motions of doing her killing and doing her job, she's getting these constant little lessons, these messages on repeat in her father's voice inside her head, telling her how to be an assassin, those lessons that were drilled into her as a child. And the twist, or the payoff at the end of the story, is that she's beginning to rebel against that, air quotes, programming. She's beginning to rebel against her father's teachings, because as you may remember from her bio, one of the things that Katarina did that caused her to be where she is right now is that she failed to carry out a mission in a way that her father wanted her to, and therefore he kind of shamed her and he disowned her, like, you're no real daughter of mine, blah blah blah. And Katarina was understandably kind of pissed about that, because she's constantly risking her life for his honor. So this story is detailing how she's starting to, in her service to General Swain, she's starting to reject some of the assassin lessons that he taught her, specifically the ones about not showing off. Katarina wants to show off. She's prideful. She's aggressive. She enjoys her work. She enjoys killing. She enjoys doing what she does. She enjoys being feared. And this is sort of a story a little bit about how she's coming to embrace that part of herself, how she's coming to embrace being a known and feared quantity in the politics of Noxus. Now, in Katarina's old lore, she was kind of exactly the opposite of that. She wasn't a thrill seeker. She was someone who was a thrill seeker when she was younger, and that caused her to make a mistake, and then that mistake was terrible, and so she decided, I will never be a thrill seeker again. I will never be passionate. I will only do the job. Raw, I have no feelings. That kind of thing. And that character was always kind of boring to me, first of all, because the dispassionate, feelingless assassin who only cares about doing the job is the oldest trope in the book, but secondly, because that doesn't really make for a lot of interesting character interactions. Usually, the only interesting thing you can really do with a character who seems to have no emotions and only care about the job is to reveal how secretly they actually do care about something other than the job, that they actually do have feelings underneath that inform their decisions or some such nonsense. And having the character have no passions and have no particular emotional attachments makes for absolutely terrible character dynamics with the other characters that they're supposed to be interacting with. And again, I will restate my belief that character interaction is the lifeblood of any good ensemble cast, like, for instance, the 140 character cast of League of Legends. For example, it makes a lot more sense to me that her and Garen would have a kind of illicit romance when Garen's whole thing is that he's the one who only cares about his duty. He's the one who's completely and utterly dedicated to always only ever doing the right thing and fulfilling his duty and doing his job and yada yada yada. And Katarina, much like Catwoman to Batman, provides a alluring alternative from that, one that says, screw your duty, screw everything you're supposed to be doing, just follow your passions, come with me, let's have a really big bloody fight and then have sex in the woods. Yeah, like, the reason why that's tempting to Garen is because it offers an alternative to the life that he does have, where he's, you know, generally not super happy because he might have to murder his sister for being a mage, that kind of thing. But if they were both that character, then their interaction would be, I only care about my duty to Demacia, and hers would be, I only care about my duty to Noxus, then we must fight, yes, we must fight, and then they'd fight, and then there'd be nothing else after. Like, there would be no way for either character to attempt to seduce the other. There would be no attraction, there would be no allure. So Message on a Blade's Edge does a good job of establishing this version of the character, although to be fair, that version of the character has existed in League of Legends for a while, in the sense that in A Twist of Fate and A New Dawn, that version of Katarina, both those versions of Katarina were much more towards that sort of hot-blooded thrill seeker than they were towards the dispassionate assassin, but it's nice to see that it's finally getting properly canonized in the written lore as well, not just in the extemporaneous animated shorts. Which moves us on to Homecoming featuring Master Yi, which was perhaps my least favorite of the stories in this particular set of updates, because it doesn't really do it really doesn't elucidate any new aspect of the Master Yi character, or particularly expand on the character who we knew already. Like, with the Annie story, I was interested to see how they were going to keep expanding on the version of Annie that they set up in the animated short, and my opinion there is that they seem a little bit confused about who they want to expand. With Katarina, it's interesting because they're doing a bit of a job sort of elucidating on the state of mind that Katarina has, and why she's becoming more and more of a thrill seeker under the service of Swain, and rebelling against her father and all that stuff. With the Master Yi one, it's sort of not really anything new there. It really doesn't do anything that we didn't already know, and that doesn't mean it's bad, it's just it's the least interesting one of the stories, at least to me. It still does perfectly good work as maintenance on the universe, it just doesn't move Master Yi as a character even a little bit. It doesn't even really feel like we spend a lot of time together with him so much as we spend some time together with his backstory. The story itself plays out in two parts. During the first part, Master Yi is trekking up a mountain that he used to live on. He comes across a farmer who is like, hey, I lost one of my little cattle creatures on this place. Could you help me look for them? And then Master Yi does help them look for them, and they find them, then they're tangled up in some weird vines that seem to be sort of unnaturally growing out and just destroying everything. And the farmer then tells Yi a whole bunch of backstory about how the magic in Ionia works, which I would assume Master Yi already knows, so I don't know why they're telling each other this stuff, but nonetheless, it's exposition for our benefit. They free the little creature so that it gets to run away, and then the farmer is like, why are you still training for battle? The war is over. And Master Yi is like, the war isn't over for me. And that seems to be the major theme of the story, as it is that Master Yi, to a certain extent, is stuck in his war trauma, and he's having trouble letting go of it. In part two of the story, he then travels up to the village, or the place that was called Wuju before the war, the destroyed, ruined place that he used to call home, and sees that it's completely overgrown with these vines. And then he does an alpha strike and clears out all the vines, and then he writes down on his little piece of paper that, oh, it's been fewer and fewer days since he's had to go up there and clear out all the vines, and eventually he's going to have to burn the whole place down to destroy the vines, to cleanse the area of what has happened, but he's still unwilling to do it. He still can't get himself to destroy the last remnants of what's left of Wuju. Now, the metaphorical resonance here is pretty strong, and it actually works quite well, that Master Yi is caught in the war trauma of the war with Noxus and the terrible atrocities that happened to his home, and the land of Ionia is also scarred by these war traumas, and Ionia manifests that trauma by creating these terrible grasping vines that are just reaching out to grab, you know, life force from anything they can get their hands on and spreading all over the place, and this horrible corruption that grasps onto everything and kind of holds onto it and will not let go. And then at the same time, Master Yi is over here having his war trauma have a big hold on him, like he can't let go of what happened in the war, he can't let go of his trauma. So there's this grasping metaphoricalness that works pretty well as the core of a story, and my disappointment is mostly that that concept wasn't expanded into something where Master Yi actually takes action and interacts with his trauma, but rather that the story we get is a story about how he's procrastinating from taking action dealing with his trauma, which is the kind of thing that really should be the first act of a much greater story about how he eventually is going to deal with the horrors of the Ionia-Noxian War. But because this is a self-contained short story, it just kind of fizzles out into nothing. Like, they can bring it up again once they give Master Yi a longer story, but here it feels more like filler than maintenance to me, is the thing I'm trying to express. Okay, that was the short stories, which leads us on to what is perhaps the more meaty and interesting part of this lore update, which is the updates to the various bios. Now, Riot Narrative Team, if you are watching this video, if you're listening to what I'm saying, and I know that occasionally you do, please do more lore patch notes like these. Like, please give us more insight into your thought process around who do we want these characters to be? Why are we making these changes that we are? Because that gives me a lot more stuff that I can argue with you about. And that makes good fodder for quality videos on YouTube.com. Please support my Patreon. So, let's talk about Udyr's bio. According to the lore patch notes, with this updated bio, we've given Udyr a backstory. He was born in unique conditions, destined to become a great spirit walker, but his swelling powers soon led to chaos as he was crippled by his own gift. We've also made a small change to the relationship between Udyr and Lee Sin, which will lead Udyr to a better understanding of his gifts through Ionia's close connection to the spirit realm. Now, the thing that's a little bit odd to me is that they say that with this updated bio, we have given Udyr a backstory, which kind of implies that he didn't have one before, but I'm looking at the previous version of his bio, and the new one is really mostly a rephrasing of the old one, with a few of the details switched out, but in large strokes, it's still exactly the same bio. Nothing material has really changed in it, so it's weird to say that you've given him a backstory. He seemed to already kind of have one, and what you've done is rephrase it a little bit so that it fits better with what you want to do with the Freljord right now, which is fine, it's just that was a weird way to phrase it. So, the actual material changes that are happening here is that in the old version of this lore, Udyr, as a child, was attacked by Lysandra herself. She came to destroy the Spirit Walker because he represented some sort of threat to her power. In the new version of the lore, it's not Lysandra herself who descends upon Udyr, but it is Lysandra's people, her frost guard, who descends upon the Winter's Claw, of which Udyr is a member. There's also the introduction of a little bit of romance, which is a new aspect to Udyr. He meets a young Iceborn who looks past his inner turmoil, and they spend some time together. The story is ambiguous about what they're doing. They're fucking. But essentially, they spend some time together, and and Udyr, otherwise being an outcast from society in the Freljord, is just glad to have someone with him. The last material change is that after Udyr has met Lee Sin and he's gone to Ionia, and the Ionian monks have kind of helped him chill the hell out and not be so angry all the time, the thing that calls him back to the Freljord is, in the old lore, it is the warning of an unnatural evil emerging from the ice. Udyr understood the true threat that the Ice Witch posed to his homeland. She was the herald of a greater darkness that would soon envelop the land, yada yada. Essentially, Udyr at this point already knows that Lysandra is aligned with the Void, or with something much like the Void, and she's going to pose a dangerous threat, and he's journeying back home in order to protect the Freljord, essentially, from her betrayal. In the new version of the lore, the spirits are somewhat vague in their call to action. Here it says, he heard the anxious cries of Freljordian spirits carried by the westerly winds, and sensed great danger stirring beyond the horizon. Bidding farewell to Ionia and Lee Sin, he set out to rejoin the Winter's Claw, knowing not how he would be received. So it's less, oh my god, you guys, Lysandra is gonna do a terrible thing, more, I got a bad feeling about this, so I better go home before the bad thing happens and I can't do anything about it. Now this seems to me to be a change primarily minted on the idea of making sure that when Lysandra betrays the Freljord, people are surprised by her betrayal, like that they don't necessarily see it coming quite so clearly as they would if a spirit walker just turned up and was like, hey, Lysandra is the bad guy. It's also interesting that rather than just being from an indeterminate Freljordian tribe that isn't really named, in this version of the lore, Udyr is specifically from the Winter's Claw, which is to say he's going to be aligned with Sejuani and her people. And that is an excellent jumping-off point to talking about Sejuani. Now, in the patch notes, they say that the circumstances of Sejuani's upbringing are the highlights of her new bio. Through this, you can see why Sejuani feels that only she is worthy of ruling the Freljord. With the recent release of Ash Warmother, we've also been able to use this as an opportunity to highlight relationships that were expanded on in that medium, as well as rightfully name Sejuani as the Warmother of the Winter's Claw. This is, again, an interesting phrasing, because Sejuani hasn't actually turned up in the Ash Warmother comics yet. She hasn't even been mentioned. She has been mentioned in Ash's updated bio, that they were childhood friends and they used to hang out, but then their mothers had a disagreement, or rather Ash's mother and Sejuani's grandmother had a disagreement. Now they're enemies because they just kind of grew apart. But as far as I know, the relationship between Ash and Sejuani is not actually due to be explored until maybe the next issue, which is called Winter's Claw, which, you know, does suggest that she's going to be turning up. So it's just a little weird that the patch notes are acting as though this expansion has already happened, and that the bio update is in response to that, because that, no, we haven't had the third issue yet, so I don't know. Sejuani has probably had the most extensive rewrite in terms of her lore of any of the characters that we're talking about today, because it really genuinely is kind of it's not a complete change of the character, but it's a complete rewrite of her circumstances. In the old lore, Sejuani is just generally just super hardcore. Like, she's just an incredibly hardcore person who gets really annoyed when anybody is not as hardcore as she is. And her story is basically, she trained herself relentlessly, and she walked into blizzards and she fought bears with her bare hands, and she became the biggest, toughest, most dangerous of all of them. And then Ash's Avarosans came along and said, hey, do you want some extra grain so you can have some food for the winter? And then she was like, hell no, I'm hardcore, I don't want any extra grain, let's have war instead. And that, I'm simplifying and I'm making a little bit of fun of it, but that's really kind of what there was to old Sejuani. The new Sejuani comes with a somewhat more complex and, I think, more interesting psychology, and one that has some interesting parallels to the ways in which Ash was raised. Sejuani is the child of an unhappy political marriage. She's the child of the Iceborn warrior Kalkia, who was the Warmother of the Winter's Claw. Kalkia, however, was not really happy in her arranged marriage, and so she just kind of left to pursue a man who she had loved many years before, and the tribe essentially just fell into complete chaos without a proper leader. So Sejuani's grandmother, Hejian, takes up leadership of the tribe, and Sejuani is raised then by her grandmother, who is not the most loving person in the world, as it turns out. She's cruel, she's demanding, and Sejuani can do absolutely nothing to earn her love. On top of that, of course, the Winter's Claw is poor. They live in poverty and despair and rely on the Frost Guard for protection. So Sejuani only ever gets to experience any sense of plenty and love and safety when she goes to visit the Avarosans, who are the sister tribe to the Winter's Claw. The Avarosans are led by Grenna, Ash's mother, and Grenna is everything that Sejuani aspires to be, and she's kind and affectionate and actually gives Sejuani praise. So Sejuani has some, what you might call, understandable envy of Ash, but nonetheless, the two young girls do become very close friends. Now, Grenna eventually notices that Sejuani is, like, being mistreated, so she talks to Hejian, the leader of the Winter's Claw, Sejuani's grandmother, and says, like, hey, maybe you should be less of a dick to your granddaughter, and Hejian does not take that very well. She, in fact, gets really pissy and cuts off all contact with the Avarosans, and then just starts being a worse and worse leader, leading the Winter's Claw ever deeper into misfortune. Kalkia, Sejuani's real mother, somehow catches wind of that and comes back and is like, okay, fine, I'll take up leadership because you guys are screwing it up so terribly. But Sejuani at this point has some issues with her birth mother, as you might imagine, some abandonment issues of various kinds, and resolves to take leadership of the Winter's Claw away from both her grandmother and her mother. In the process, she also wants to free the Winter's Claw from the influence of the Frost Guard, which of course is directly contrary to Lysandra's interests, although she does not really become a character specifically in this bio. Lysandra's Frost Priests, however, try to intervene in the duel between Kalkia and Sejuani, and Kalkia is killed in the struggle. Sejuani then consolidates her power over the Winter's Claw. She rejects the Frost Guard, the Frost Priests. She throws out Lysandra's faithful and starts attracting to herself spirit walkers, shamans, iceborn, stormborn, and all kinds of people who have been alienated and rejected by Lysandra's power regime, which swells her ranks and makes her tribe the center of worship for the old gods from before the time of Lysandra across the Freljord. Now, this is interesting to me for a few reasons, because the Avarosans, the Frost Guard, and the Winter's Claw were always meant to be sort of a trio of different aspects of the Freljord that were in competition with one another for dominance over the region. But the differences between them were never really, like, super clear. Like, it used to be, like, the Sandra and the Frostguard were, like, these secretive, mysterious magic people, and then the Winter's Claw were just, like, the aggressive assholes who were trying to destroy everything and raid and pillage and just wanted to fight for no good reason. And then the Avarosans were the obviously good people who had no trouble whatsoever, and they were the obvious, like, they were the nice, peaceful solution, la 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 la. Here, we see a slightly more complicated picture where Sejuani and Ash are both in open rebellion against Lysandra. Ash is in rebellion because the worship of Avarosa and the tribes that she is gathering to herself is a challenge to Lysandra's power, but Sejuani, on the other hand, is a challenge because she's gathering to her all those people who are alienated and rejected by Lysandra's dominance. She's gathering the people who have different religions than the Frostborn religion. She's gathering people who will not be subject to the powers of Lysandra and the Frostguard, who will not listen to the Frost Priests, and are challenging the religious authority of the Ice Witch. And what's interesting about that is that that should make Ash and Sejuani natural allies in the fight against Lysandra, but the reason why they're not natural allies doesn't come down to the Winter's Claw wanting to fight and the Avarosans wanting peace. It comes down to Sejuani having a very personal grudge with Ash. Ash, who grew up with a mother who loved her. Ash, who grew up in a tribe that had food enough for the winter. Ash, who had everything that Sejuani was never allowed to have. Everything that Sejuani has ever had to fight for her entire life to achieve. Ash, well, from Sejuani's perspective, probably just had handed to her. Sejuani knows Ash's mother as a powerful warrior, the ideal war leader, the ideal war mother of a tribe of the Freljord, and now here comes Ash walking along with all of this hippy-dippy, let's all just get along and have a nice big tribe and grow food instead of fighting weak sauce nonsense. And so from Sejuani's perspective, Ash has completely betrayed the values of Grenna. She's completely betrayed the values that a war mother is supposed to stand for. This is a personal vendetta. It is a personal grudge and a personal relationship. This, to me, is a lot more interesting than it just being about, oh, the Avarosans don't want to fight and the Winter's Claw want to fight, so therefore they're enemies, even though Lysandra is over there trying to summon elder gods. Like, it makes more sense to me that they're animosity and their enmity comes down to something which is profoundly personal and kind of petty and rooted in deep-seated emotions, which is then couched in high-minded ideals about, oh, you should be strong warriors and the Avarosans don't want to be strong warriors, and that's why we're fighting them, and not because I have just massive unresolved mommy issues and I'm kind of taking them out on my former friend because that's the only way I know how to reestablish control over my own life. It also gives Lysandra a natural point of leverage, a natural way to manipulate Ash and Sejuani into fighting each other instead of standing together against the Frostguard and the coming of the, you know, void. So, this new Sejuani bio and the specific relationship between Ash and Sejuani is probably going to get expanded upon in Ash Warmother issues 3 and 4 once they come out, and at that point maybe we can talk more about them, but for the moment at least, I think the dynamic that's being set up between the three leaders of the Freljord here is a lot more interesting than the one we used to have. It used to be that they were essentially three figureheads. They were three sort of personalized avatars of a very abstract set of values that were clashing against each other, and here, now, we have a set of personalities that are clashing against each other, which makes, I think, for much better storytelling and much more exploitable character dynamics when it comes to creating a plot around it. This leads us finally on to the bio update for Jarvan, and this one probably has the longest discussion attached to it, but we're not going to be having it right now, because the discussion I want to have around Jarvan is primarily a discussion around him and Silas. I have done a previous video about the rather messy biography that Jarvan used to have, so let's talk specifically about some of the things that have been changed here, because in the broad strokes, there isn't that much new stuff in here. The major new thing that's happening, though, is that in the old bio, it says this. The Demacian ruler is chosen by a high council from a selection of worthy families, but the last three kings were descendants of the same line. As King Jarvan III's only child, Jarvan IV was groomed since birth to continue that tradition. So, in the old version of Jarvan's bio, we are told that in Demacia, the king is chosen from a selection of worthy candidates by a noble council. That is to say, the kingship is not necessarily hereditary, although there apparently there is a bit of a tendency to choose people from the same family over and over again. Technically, they could choose someone else if no worthy candidate from the Jarvan family shows up. In the new version of the lore, however, Jarvan is born as heir apparent. He is born to be king. Everybody assumes he's going to be king. The kingship is hereditary. The reason why that's important is because that interacts pretty substantially with some of the themes that are going on with Silas's story, which is why I'd rather cover that in a separate video specifically about the politics of Demacia. For the moment, though, let's just note the fact that it's pretty notable that this sort of pretension towards meritocracy has at least finally been abandoned in this version of Demacia, and it is a full-on feudal, hereditary monarchy. As for Jarvan's connections to other characters, the connection to Xin Shao is still a little bit tenuous. Like, it's pretty much just like Xin Shao just shows up at once and is like, Xin Shao teaches him things about stuff, especially Ionia, and then Xin Shao's relationship with Jarvan is never really expanded upon ever again in the bio. So that was like a minor fix just to kind of mention him in the bio, but it wasn't really an expansion on their relationship. As for other changes, his relationship with Garen has actually been a little bit reduced in the new version of the bio. In the old version, Jarvan leads a military expedition against the Noxians. He gets overconfident or a little bit too eager to fight. He gets himself into a bad position, gets captured, and then it's Garen who leads a rescue force to come and get him out of the camp. Then he's shot in the side with an arrow, then he eventually ends up meeting Shyvana, and then the story proceeds from there. In the new version, he's never rescued by Garen because he's never captured. He just tries to flee the Noxians, then he gets shot, then he meets Shyvana, then he fights Shyvana's mom alongside Shyvana, and then he comes home again. Exactly why they wanted to remove that bit about Garen rescuing Jarvan, I don't really know. That feels, if anything, like they're putting more distance between the two men rather than trying to bring them closer together or clarify their relationship. It might just be that they don't want Jarvan to be too closely in debt to Garen for future storylines where Garen is like, holy crap, I can't ask for help from anyone, and yet I need to keep the secret that my sister is a mage and I have to kill her to kind of heighten that drama. I don't know. That's not really made clear here, but I guess we'll see an expansion upon that in the Lux and Garen comic that they have announced for, I think, later in this year. Now, most of the discussion I want to have about Jarvan has to do with Silas, but my main problem is this. Jarvan is too good. Like, in this version of the story, he's written as the perfect, kind, gentlemanly, educated, scholarly, compassionate, honorable prince who just wants the best for his people and always wants to do the right thing and who doesn't want to see any injustices done and who's probably more tolerant towards magic and who would be open to giving mages equal rights in Demacia and maybe ending the persecutions. But the whole point of Silas, this new major character who's been introduced into Demacia, is that Demacia is not willing to do those things. Demacia is not just. Demacia does not actually care about the lives of mages and oppresses them and commits genocide against them. And Jarvan doesn't work as an antagonist in that story. Like, at all. It's really hard to see how they're going to build a proper dynamic, a proper antagonism between the two that isn't just Silas is a massive dick and Jarvan is doing his best, so stop harassing him. So yeah, that too is going to need some expansion, but perhaps we can have a little bit of a conversation about that when we tackle Silas's lore that was recently released in a future video. But first, we're gonna be dealing with Soraka. Anyway, if you've enjoyed this video, then thank you very much. There's a like button down below, there's a subscribe button down below, there's a bell icon down below, and if you click on all of them, that's good and helpful for me. You can also leave a comment, which is also helpful with the algorithms and stuff, and plus, I like reading those. If you want to help out the channel in other ways, well, you can head on over to Patreon and subscribe for whatever. If you have a dollar that you don't mind giving away every month to, well, specifically to me, then you can do that over on Patreon.com, and that really, like, Patreon is substantially more of a help in paying my rent than the ad revenue on this channel. Like, that's really the bread and butter of how I'm able to literally keep the lights on. So thank you very much if you want to do that. If you don't want to subscribe to a thing and give money every month and stuff, but you just want to give me, like, a one-time tip to say, hey, good job, you can head on over to Ko-fi, which there's a link to down in the description, and should be coming up on screen shortly as well, where you can give a one-time donation to sort of give me a extra big thumbs up and say good job. That would also be very nice of you. Additionally, I stream every Saturday at 8 p.m. Central European Standard Time, which is 1 p.m. Eastern Time, I think. And currently, we're streaming through the 2018 God of War game on the PS4 while trying to explain all the Norse mythology behind it, because Norse mythology is a bit of a passion project of mine, and it is also my mythology, because I live in Scandinavia. So if you're interested in that, you can come along and have fun on the stream. We have a nice meme about using compasses on things, which is funny. Please come to my streams, I'm lonely. If you haven't enjoyed this video, of course, there's also an option for you. In that case, down below this video, you will find the dislike button, and if you so desire, you can click on it. Although I should warn you that there is a non-zero chance that by clicking on the dislike button, somewhere down the line, 2 months from now, 6 months from now, 9 months from now, someone will completely rewrite your entire biography, and nobody's even gonna know what the deal is with you anymore, and nobody's gonna have any idea how you're working and why, like, what's your connection? What about your old best friend? He's just been written completely out of the story. He's not even there anymore. You're gonna look in the mirror, and a completely different person is gonna look back at you with completely different mechanics, and all your friends and family are gonna start looking at you weird, like they're gonna look at you like, oh man, you were so much better 3 years ago. You know, just nowadays, you're not even interesting anymore. Like, I used to be so passionate about you, but now you're just boring, and I don't even really want to hang out with you anymore, because, like, it's like you changed all the stuff that made you good, man. I just can't fall in love with it anymore. I guess I'm just abandoning you to play Overwatch. And it's not even like you're gonna be getting worse or anything. Objectively, you're just gonna be getting better, and you're gonna be looking nicer, and you're gonna have nicer things, but everybody around you is still gonna be weirdly negative and complaining about everything you do and every little thing that changes, and it's gonna be so frustrating because you don't know how to please anyone. You don't know how to make them happy anymore, and you just don't know what to do with yourself. And you, some guy on YouTube starts making videos about you and complaining about you and saying that your story isn't even as good as it used to be, and he has all these weirdly specific opinions about your character design, and I mean, who wants to live like that? Thank you very much for watching.